From immigrant paperboy to factory owner, Sam Regenstrief embodied the American dream. His success in business marked only the beginning of what would become a lasting legacy in the state of Indiana. The institute that bears his name continues a tradition of research and innovation, which improves the outcomes of patients and the capacity of medical professionals. This is the story of one man's journey that sparked the creation of a unique organization, which continues to explore new frontiers a half century after its founding.
One time, I was taking him to Richmond to his factory up there. He wanted me to do something, and I didn't do it. I told him I couldn't. So he told me I was fired. I said, okay, that's the way it is. I pulled off the side of the road and started to get out of the car. And there was a fella in the back seat. That fella says, where are you going, Dick? I said, Sam told me I was fired, and I'm going out to catch a ride back to town. He says, I'm not going to sit here with this car and drive it. Sam says, get over there in the seat and drive. He said, we got to get to Richmond. But he was just that way. There'll never be another one like him.
Many words have been used to describe Sam Regenstrief. Everything from cantankerous and controlling to generous and humble. The man who would become known to many as the Dishwasher King made it his mission in life not to waste time. Rather, his goal was to teach people and create production systems that could operate as efficiently as possible. But before Sam could build an empire, he had to help his family simply survive the beginning of the 20th century. One of seven children, no one knows exactly when Sam was born. It's believed the year was either 1906 or 1910. He and his family moved to America when he was very young. The new country held great promise for the Regenstriefs, but as Sam would quickly learn, success was only achieved with hard work. And having a good sense for business didn't hurt either. Sam's father was busy running a bakery and worked long hours to feed his large family. Sam's mother was frequently confined to bed because of influenza and then Parkinson's disease. She died when Sam was only 17. Sam and his older siblings were often called upon to raise their younger siblings. With that responsibility came Sam's chance to provide them with an education on the art of making money. Sam's first employees were his younger brothers, whom he paid to sell the Indianapolis News at his stands on the corner of Meridian and Washington Streets. Along with selling newspapers, Sam took a job at the Real Silk Hosiery Mills in Indianapolis. Sam's business acumen resulted in extra money for the family, and this early work ethic foreshadowed the entrepreneurial spirit he would later embody. Like most Hoosiers, Sam Regenstrief enjoyed the game of basketball. He coached teams and even gained quite the reputation as a basketball official. There was one game that Sam would never forget. While attending a high school sectional game with a friend at Butler Fieldhouse, the friend introduced Sam to Miss Murdy Barnett of Franklin, Indiana. Apparently, the chemistry was right. Sam and Murdy were married on October 5, 1940, in Brookville, Indiana. Sam and Murdy settled down in a modest home at the corner of 8th and Oak in Connersville, Indiana, not far from the Rex Manufacturing Company. At the age of 29, Sam became the president of Rex, a company that specialized in manufacturing steel refrigerator cabinets. As Sam managed the plant operations by cutting costs and increasing labor productivity, Murdy spent her time volunteering as a nurse's aide in the Fayette Memorial Hospital and serving on the Red Cross board. And she was also active in the town's Girl Scout program. Though Sam and Murdy did not have children of their own, they took great pride doting on their nieces and nephews.
I spent my summers with them starting at the age of 7. And until I went off to college, I think I spent every summer with them. And they were warm. They were generous. My aunt was particularly soft-spoken. My uncle was not soft-spoken. Uncle Sam was very funny and was a very good match.
During the next 20 years, Sam's career evolved as the Rex Manufacturing Company became a subsidiary of the Philco Company. Sam remained as president of Rex and worked his way up the Philco management ladder. Some people would suggest that Sam's success in the appliance business was due to his ability to take a chance on an innovation. True to form, Sam's desire to innovate and to always be looking for new challenges came to fruition in 1959. Sam decided the time was right to move on an idea he had been thinking about for many years: automatic home dishwashers.
Sam had worked in the industry of things like refrigerators, washers, those kind of things. And he got the idea that after World War II, as people were rebuilding their lives and aspiring to have their own homes, that everyone should be able to have a dishwasher in their home. So the way to do that would be to make dishwashers on an industrial scale where they were economical and efficient and they were affordable. So he got into the wholesale dishwasher business and made dishwashers through an assembly line approach. And then he was the wholesaler, and so others then sold those dishwashers, like Sears in particular.
Sam's new company, the Design and Manufacturing Company, or D&M, entered into competition with the big players of the home appliance industry, with companies like GE, General Motors, owner of the Frigidaire name, Westinghouse, and Whirlpool. Dishwashers were one of the most complicated of all home appliances to manufacture. With Sam's intellect and management skills, D&M was able to increase its volume and make the best dishwasher for the lowest cost in the business. Sam Regenstrief had started his company in January 1959 with 100 employees manufacturing 60,000 units. By January 1972, his refurbished Connersville plant employed more than 1,500 workers, and D&M was the world's largest manufacturer of dishwashing machines. Business success was not the only thing that drove Sam Regenstrief. Sam was once quoted as saying, "I feel that the social problems that face this country arise from the great divergence in the quality of life."
I rolled into Connersville in 1961.
He was involved in everything in Connersville. He put on an M day, and that's where they had everything to eat, you know, and everybody brought their families, and they had games, and he was right in there working, helping do stuff.
So thank you, Connersville, and thanks to you, old Indiana.
He at one point had an opportunity to be a patient at Marion County General Hospital.
He was in town attending an executive session and had a gallbladder attack. And they took him into the ER and put him on a gurney.
The ER back then was in the same building as the outpatient. He had time to watch what he called an inefficient operation in his own mind.
For someone like Sam Regenstrief, the expert in efficiency, the experience of waiting for health care struck a nerve. He was quoted to have remarked, "I can go anywhere in the world to get health care. I can pay and get the best there is. But these people have no choice. They have to sit here and wait all day. Surely there is something we can do about this." Sam's experience in the hospital waiting room was the spark that started him thinking that he certainly could lend his experience to tackling this problem.
Sam Regenstrief really experienced firsthand the inefficiencies of healthcare for people who are poor. And it was back in the 60s, so there was still segregation. Not everybody could go to the same hospital. Not everybody could go to the same healthcare providers. He experienced that firsthand and recognized that everyone should have the same ability to be healthy. He said, "I believe that the social problems that face this country today arise from the great divergence in the quality of life." And that was back in the 60s. I've been studying health disparities and health equity for my entire career, which is about 25 years. And even before that, even before the social determinants of health were part of research, he understood the social determinants of health. It was like he stood at the edge of the water and looked at the horizon and understood what could be if he could take technology and add it to healthcare.
Fortunately for Sam, there were several key figures in his life that were able to help him focus his energy and his finances on the perplexing inefficiency issues in the field of medicine.
I'm a relative by marriage. My wife is their niece. She was very close to them, and for a variety of reasons, I got to know Sam quite well. I was his conduit for medical care between Connersville and D&M, his company, and the IU Medical Center. I even had a kind of executive health screening program for his executives. And we would discuss a lot of items, including medical care, and that's how this all came about, actually.
There were some people here that at that time that had some exciting ideas about how to improve health. He basically decided if we could do something that took the same approach that I take towards making dishwashers and apply that same philosophy to delivery of health care, maybe we'd have a lot better system. And so that was the fundamental idea, and I would posit that that need still exists today, probably even more so than back then.
The Regenstrief Institute, from its inception, was and is dedicated to finding pathways to improve healthcare, taking discoveries and taking new advancements and moving them into healthcare, into practice. So that's quite astonishing to think about that mission in the 1950s and 60s.
Sam said in an interview years later, the idea is to use new industry technology to build up cost containment and productivity of people. That is what counts in whatever you are doing. And so it was that on April 7, 1967, on the advice of Drs. John Hickam and Harvey Feigenbaum of the IU School of Medicine's Department of Medicine, Sam and Murty Regenstrief created the Regenstrief Foundation, Incorporated. The avowed purpose of the foundation was, quote, to bring to the practice of medicine the most modern scientific advances from engineering, business, and the social sciences, and to foster the rapid dissemination into medical practice of the new knowledge created by research. A new era in making healthcare more efficient was about to begin. The Institute's mission would be to pull together a group of world-class doctors, consultants, and research staff, and to use the hospital setting as a research laboratory to try out better ways of delivering healthcare.
I was lucky in the fact I was hired so soon after the Institute was formed, so I grew up with it. I hired or interviewed over 1,000 people in the years I was there. So I could think, will they fit in? Is this the kind of place that would be good for them? As we hired people, I talked to them about the spirit of the Institute, that we were a happy place to work. And I gave each of them, when we had it written, the legacy of the dishwashing king, Mr. Regenstrief's book. I think that made a culture. It worked. I mean, we did a lot of fun things, but everyone worked really hard too.
I think the biggest strengths of the Institute really relate to our people and our innovations. So we have an incredible group of researchers and investigators and staff who are really the leading experts in the world in what we do in informatics and health services research, trying to really come up with the cutting edge solutions over the last 50 years that have really defined what we think of as modern day health information technology, electronic health records, improvements in the way we practice and deliver healthcare, improvements in the way we care for the aging population. These are really driven by the expertise of our people. And I think beyond that, we have incredible assets and resources in terms of a lot of the data infrastructure that we have and a lot of the technology infrastructure that has been developed and really grown out of the work of our people that put us in a wonderful position to be able to have a huge impact not only locally with our health system partners, but also regionally and globally.
I don't think people knew much about the Institute really when those first pioneers were beginning to explore medical decision making. There was work here that under the title of industrial engineering. And then you had the group that was interested in computers.
It's been a considerable evolution. Early on, some experiments were done in actually trying to set up clinics. Most of those were done with the predecessor of Eskenazi Health. And then things evolved, and the biggest step in that evolution was probably the recruitment of Clem McDonald.
It was a wild ride. So I was working at Cook County Hospital, and my boss would offer me a job there as a resident. I was a resident and would do all the things I wanted to do with computers, make a computer record system.
And at that time, that was a really radical idea. And Clem was this young, wild guy who was trained as a physician, but who was really skilled with computers. And he had these audacious ideas that you could use a computer to basically figure out almost anything, including the structure of proteins and all that kind of stuff. So Clem came on board, and then that's where a lot of the energy went to developing systems that were computer-based that could really help improve the care of patients. And those were basically taken into the clinic, and the clinic was used as a laboratory to prove that approach could make a difference.
We didn't have a computer here at the very beginning. It was up at Purdue. The Purdue engineers would just take it down anytime they wanted, and we're trying to build a system. So after about 6 months, we got our own computer down here, and life worked better. The guys up there decided they could make a cheaper terminal for us, that is, because it cost about $8,000 for a computer terminal back then. And they came down with this thing, was an open board with 50,000 volt capacitors on it, and they're thinking this is gonna be set up on the wards. I said, you know, it ain't gonna work, but it was cheap.
Now it seems self-evident, but you have to put yourself back in the 1970s when someone like Clem McDonald would have been seen as incredibly innovative or perhaps a little bit odd, wanting to apply computers to what people might have regarded as an art.
Back in the beginning, Sam Regenstrief was a man much like Clem, actually, both very high energy. Sam did not understand much of what Clem was trying to do, I'm sure. Sam was a great evaluator of people. He saw Clem as someone who maybe was high risk, but also had the potential for being high reward.
Marion County General Hospital became Wishart Hospital and is now Eskenazi Hospital. In Sam's time, it was not the state-of-the-art facility that it is now. Patients once waited for care in a huge outpatient waiting room. The room was so large, it was compared to that of a train station. With wooden pews, all lined up like one would see in a church, a patient might wait most of the day to see a doctor, and then finish the day waiting to have a prescription filled. People used to make a social event of it, bringing their lunches for a day-long encampment. From picnicking at Marion County General to receiving the state-of-the-art care at the current Eskenazi Hospital, local as well as international patients have benefited greatly from the 50-year partnership that developed between the Regenstrief Institute and the Indianapolis Health Systems.
I think maybe a lot of people don't realize that some of the earliest work in developing the earliest electronic health records were done here at the Regenstrief Institute in the early 70s. The early versions of what we now think of as modern day health information technologies and electronic health records were invented here and used to care for people right here in Indiana, and then have been spun out to the rest of the world. A lot of our technologies and solutions and processes being adopted by what are now prevailing electronic medical record systems and other health information technologies.
Wishart, and now Eskenazi's success as a safety net health system, can be in large part attributed to the mutually beneficial relationship that we enjoyed with the Regenstrief Institute over that 50-year period of time. A lot of this evolved as part of our partnership in developing and deploying one of the world's first electronic medical record systems, and along with that, the computer physician order entry system that forms the template for really all of the others that followed.
If you look at all of the components of it, the leadership of the Regenstrief Institute in electronic health records, we're number one. What happens over the years, there were more people like me and my colleagues who could say, yes, but could we apply that to this particular condition or this particular group of people? And the two partners saw their complementary strengths, that Eskenazi could provide this laboratory and make it safe and profitable to the patients.
it is not overreaching to say that the work of Regenstrief Institute has had a positive impact on every aspect of the quality, the safety, the efficiency, and the effectiveness of care that we provide within our health system.
That partnership has continued and it's flourished, and there are people and programs at Eskenazi that simply would not exist if Regenstrief had never existed. And the same is true for Regenstrief. And it's that synergy that the two have enjoyed that really keeps them joined together.
We've got a great hospital partner in Eskenazi that is really open to us doing our investigative work and helping patients and helping providers give the best care possible through evidence-based practice. When you have this shared mission and you have access to their resources and we can combine resources to learn, it makes it very helpful. It's really interesting that part of what we do is develop these long-standing relationships. I have a relationship with the health coaches. I have a relationship, some of whom are Regenstrief Institute investigators, but they're providers who refer their patients to Healthy Me. And we can find ways to help overweight and obese individuals lose weight and live a healthy life.
Alongside their innovations in electronic medical records, the Regenstrief Institute began developing a way to enable health systems to share those records. The system is called Logical Observation Identifiers, Names, and Codes, or LOINC. LOINC is a universal language for identifying health measurements and observations. The common codes allow different health organizations, testing companies, laboratories, and more to exchange information. LOINC is now used by several United States federal agencies and is actively used in 177 countries around the world. In addition to this work, the Institute has also played key roles in improving healthcare in the developing world. Regenstrief scientists have helped make high-quality electronic medical records and health information infrastructures available worldwide in areas where resources are limited.
The establishment of really critical and fundamental data standards like LOINC really drives a lot of data interchange and interoperability. We're invented here and we still manage. And then a lot of inventions and innovations in terms of care delivery. How do we better identify and care for people when they're in the hospital, when they're transitioning from the health systems to home or to nursing homes? And how do we actually improve processes for how we care for people with various diseases, from stroke and cancer to dementia to the care of people in the intensive care unit? A lot of the best practices and solutions for how we care, how we deliver care, and how we drive improvements in people's health have come from innovations here.
Regenstrief Institute, they've always had three major areas. One is informatics. I mean, most people know what informatics is about, and aging research. This area of health services research is always a bit harder to explain to people. It's fairly diverse. Some people do research on improving healthcare systems, patient-centered care. Others focus on specific conditions, study symptoms like pain and depression. That's been a real opportunity because in particular the VA has been interested in pain. It's had interest in disorders like depression, better uses of testing like colonoscopy. I would say that the VA relationship for health services research is fundamental.
I'm really excited to be a part of the future of Regenstrief Institute and where we go the next 50 years because of how there's so much potential ahead of us in figuring out and how to optimize telehealth and delivering care via video, and figuring out how do we access new forms of data as new kinds of information comes out, and how do we really set up the data infrastructure so that we can do good research with that type of data. How do we deliver better care that improves the health of our community, both in Indiana and beyond?
So we have a lot that we can build upon, and I think a lot of impact that we're looking to have. One of the things we want to achieve as a society and as a health system is to create what we call a learning health system, a system that can learn systematically. We want to take every opportunity of care, of data collection, of experience, and be able to use those as opportunities to learn how do we provide better care, how do we make better diagnoses, prevent disease, ultimately treat people more efficiently and effectively, and cure them, and ultimately get people back to good health. So creating learning health systems and doing that in collaboration with our health system partners and with others is a key step for the future.
There's a long list of clinical approaches that we have demonstrated that have made their way out into the world for improving outcomes after stroke, for managing diabetes and hypertension and pain. These are narrower groups of patients. We are thought of as one of the people when you want to put together a national consortium that has anything to do with health services research, clinical trials in older adults, and particularly around Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. But we're not just invited to participate. Sometimes we are the ones leading that consortium.
In addition to their successes in Alzheimer's and dementia care, Regenstrief researchers help nursing homes provide better care and reduce avoidable trips to the hospital. They have also conducted extensive research and spread awareness about improving intensive care practices, handling of anticholinergic medications, which are linked to dementia, and palliative and end-of-life care. These research initiatives are aimed toward better care for patients, enhanced connection and resources for family and caregivers, and lower costs to patients and healthcare systems.
We have some of the greatest thinkers in their respective areas of informatics and health services research and aging research really thinking about what are the problems that need to be solved, what are the kinds of issues that need solutions, and how do we bring the best evidence forward, how do we develop that evidence, and how do we then apply that to improve people's lives. The passion that our researchers and staff have, the degree to which people work so diligently to solve those problems, and the other differentiator, I think, is the degree to which so many of our people are really working in the field, working in the applied space, work that actually goes out and touches individuals, and the translation of discoveries into practice and ultimately taking that out into the market or into practice environments or into people's homes is what we're really excellent at, and our people are some of the best in the world at that.
It's just amazing to be here, to be surrounded by colleagues who have the same ethics and who have the same goals as I do with this really vulnerable population who could be my mom or my dad, and actually they get healthcare here too and have participated in research studies to make their lives better. I feel like they feel like they know us and they can trust us and they want to participate in our research. And so it makes it much easier. I think the two threats to research are funding and recruitment. If you don't have funding, you can't do the research. And if you don't have research participants, when you're doing research science with humans, you can't do your research. And if they're afraid of you or if they don't trust you, they're not going to enroll in your studies. And this institute has really provided an environment where people feel safe and welcome and respected and want to enroll in our studies. I don't know that I could do that anywhere else.
I joined a Regenstrief Institute because of the people here. That's what drew me to the institute. I wanted to work with the leading expert in patient-provider communication. I wanted to work with the researcher who pioneered teaching seniors how to use the internet for healthcare purposes. I wanted to work with the authors who I cited in my own dissertation paper and who are citing my work in their own syllabus for their classes. And it's really this interdisciplinary team of health communication experts and health information technology experts that I wanted to work with. But I really wanted to join a center and a broader institute, actually, that has this cross-cutting expertise in health information technology and health communication, because that's the work that excites me. Those are my people.
The institute's in a wonderful position. It has this wonderful foundation of credibility and well-deserved visibility. It has a similar reputation for excellence in professional development. It has a similar reputation for excellence in research. And that is now in a position where it wasn't, say, 20, 30 years ago, to have much greater impact.
I think another area of enormous opportunity and growth, given our aging population, is a lot of the work that we need to do to help innovate in terms of caring for people where they are, both in terms of their life and in terms of where they live. And there's a lot of phenomenal work happening in our aging center in that regard.
I think it's rosy because they're on all the tracks that are important to healthcare right now.
certainly aging. The country's getting older. We're like breaking all kinds of records on numbers over 65. And health services research is very important to make care more efficient and more closer to accomplishing what people want, what the patients want.
I think another area of great opportunity for the future is in the area of data and artificial intelligence and what we can do to really demonstrate not only how we better use those methods and approaches to be able to actually better predict and prevent and treat conditions and help individuals better manage and control their own future and their own health, but also to do that ethically and appropriately and be able to use data for good. I think that's a really key area where, because of the nature of who we are, how we work in this applied space, and what our researchers really have expertise in, I think that's an area we're going to have great impact.
Victory can be declared. You know, we've built an electronic medical record, we've proved that it's a good thing, and now the marketplace has taken that over. But then, now the question then is, these records are amassing enormous quantities of data. So how do you sift through it? How do you analyze it and use that as a way to figure out better ways to deliver care?
It won't surprise anyone for there to be a 100-year anniversary. It has that kind of a strong foundation, and that is the great amount of need for an institution like this and the huge amount of work that's left to be done.
Few discoveries happen in a matter of one's lifetime. Usually it's cumulative. So if we believe in the importance of the areas we're studying, we want that to be continued to be studied beyond the time we research. I've been pleased by the progress made in reaching out outside the Regenstrief walls, and I see that happening in healthcare and in community, and I don't think we can go it alone. I think there's a lot of issues we could tackle out there, but it'll be more effective if we work together with the stakeholders and partners, and I see that increasingly happen.
I think the opportunity to do more impactful work at the area of how we improve health services, how we better deliver care, how do we make that more efficient and effective, especially as we see healthcare changing, where increasingly where people get their healthcare and how they get their healthcare is changing. It's not necessarily going to be in the traditional environments in the future. It's going to be increasingly at home or on your smartphone or in ways we can't even imagine today. And there's a lot of important research that needs to happen that our people can lead in terms of how we do that better. There's also enormous opportunities and need to understand how we can bring these non-traditional data sources to bear so that we have a much better picture of all the things that impact someone's health. Traditionally, we've thought about healthcare innovation and healthcare research as being about what happens in the health system, in the hospital, or in the clinic. But we know that what really has the major impact on all of our health are often things that relate to how we live, how active we are, what we eat, the air we're breathing, how we experience interactions with others. And all of those factors increasingly become part of the social determinants that we combine with health data in order to be able to better enable people to become and remain healthy. And there's a lot of important research that's happening there.
Sam Regenstrief could not have imagined the impact his life's work would have on advancements in the healthcare system. Sam's story of building a business from humble beginnings in a small town in Indiana to planting the seed for what would become a world-renowned research institute continues to inspire. Sam's inquisitive nature and passion for streamlining processes propelled him to financial success in the manufacturing world.
We're really lucky to have Sam and Murdy Regenstrief. Sam was an incredible industrial engineer who developed some of the very processes that made his company most efficient and effective at the time. He wanted to see those efficiencies and improvements brought to healthcare. And that's really what this institute has been doing for the last 50 years.
The institute's in a wonderful, well-deserved foundation of visibility for good work. It has a similar reputation for excellence in research.
With the creation of the foundation and then the institute, they really were an extraordinary team that really needs to be recognized, that Aunt Murdy and Uncle Sam had this dream together and that they, as a couple, really moved to see it happen.
I believe he would be very proud of what we've accomplished and even more proud of the direction we're heading.
The first half century of the Regenstrief Foundation and the Regenstrief Institute has produced a partnership with Indiana University that has delivered cutting-edge outcomes for the healthcare industry. The ability to partner with academia and industry illustrates that the Institute's future is bright, as its research scientists develop the next generation of health and information technology solutions in the next half century.